morning and welcome to Indian Hill Church. We're so glad that you've chosen to worship with us on this third Sunday of Advent.
God's anointed one is coming to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and to announce a time of the Lord's favor.
Because the world is broken and the wait is long, but our joy cannot be contained.
Like a toddler toppling the thrones of power with a gleeful swipe, joy pierces our silence with song, interrupts our sighing with laughter, unshackles our fumbling feet to dance.
My soul magnifies the Lord, she whispers, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior.
A reading from the book of Isaiah, chapter 61, verses 1 through 4 and 8 through 11. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, to display his glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins, they shall raise up the former devastations, they shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. For I, the Lord, love justice, I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their recompense, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants shall be known among the nations, and their offspring among the peoples. All who see them shall acknowledge that they are a people whom the Lord has blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord, my whole being shall exult in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation, he has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all the nations.
Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
So we light one candle because it only takes one, Christ with us.
The people who walked in the darkness have seen a great light.
Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined.
Listen to God's holy and God's living word. It comes to us from the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verses 6 through 8, 19 through 28. There was a man sent by God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you a prophet?" He answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" John said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah nor Elijah nor a prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." This took place in Bethany, across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. Let us hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people. Thanks be to God. Good morning. Let us pray. God of hope, you call us home from the exile of selfish oppression, to the freedom of justice, to the balm of healing, to the joy of sharing. So this morning we pray that you will strengthen us to join in your holy work, welcoming friends, welcoming strangers, welcoming victims, companions of those whom others shun and turn away, that all may share in the happiness we find through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Who are you? What a question. Growing up in the South, I answered this question by telling who my people are. My parents, grandparents, and whatnot. Some folks give full accounting of their family tree to answer that question. Other parts of the country, you answer that question by telling you where you went to school or what you do for a living. You answer differently depending on the custom of the place. Apparently here in Cincinnati, when you tell someone who you are, you must include where you went to school. High school, that is. East side or west side. That tells them something of who you are. Which gets to, how do we really tell someone who we are? John the Baptist, in our gospel reading from the Gospel of John, found it easier to tell people who he wasn't than who he was. The crowds of curious folks asked him, "Who are you?" And John answered, "I am not the Messiah." They asked if he was Elijah. He answered, "No." "Are you then a prophet?" He answered, "No." Basically, what he was saying is, "I'm not important, but I am the one who points to someone who is important." So the gospel writer of John has John the Baptist pointing to Jesus. In the other three gospels, John the Baptist is given a whole lot more of a narrative, a story. He's a prophet. He has an important ministry. He wears camel hair and eats locusts and honey. And he preaches a message of repentance. Then he dies as a martyr for daring to confront the earthly powers that are against him. But for the Gospel of John, his role is to point to Jesus. As a matter of fact, in this passage tells us more about who John the Baptist wasn't than about who he was. He wasn't the light, but he pointed to the light. He wasn't the Messiah, but he pointed to the Messiah. He wasn't Elijah, he wasn't a prophet. Who was he? He was a witness. He was a voice crying in the wilderness, telling people to prepare for someone else. Someone who was to come, that John would not even be able to untie his shoestrings. John the Baptist here is actually making somewhat of a negative confession. Notice that John's testimony isn't actually all that articulate or powerful. About all John can say is that he is not the Messiah. He's not Elijah. He's not a prophet. And anyone that any one of his questioners should really be concerned about, he is not the important one. John is just a voice crying in the wilderness, pointing the way to the one who is to come, the much more important one. So when you think about it, John the Baptist is doing exactly what all of us are encouraged to do. We are encouraged to point to Jesus. It's often lost on the church because we try so hard to be like Jesus. What would Jesus do? So we try to do what Jesus did. Love like he did, care like he did, do the things that Christ called his followers to do. But we also lose sight that we're not capable of being a savior or a Messiah. Instead, we are encouraged to point to him. For we are not Jesus. We cannot do what Jesus did. We can't walk on water. We cannot raise the dead. We cannot heal the sick. We cannot make the blind see or the lame walk. So we have to be honest with ourselves before we can point to the one who is to come, before we can bear witness to Jesus. We must first say, we are not Jesus. We are not the Savior of the world. We are not the Messiah. We cannot do what he did. Of course, we know that Scripture says that Jesus tells us, greater works than these you will do. I believe it's true, but that's not our end game. That's not our purpose. So before we can work these great wonders, we must realize we are not the Savior. We are not Jesus. We already have a Savior. Instead, we are like John the Baptist, voices crying in the wilderness, pointing to the one who is to come, pointing and giving voice to the babe in a manger. I've watched many TV shows and movies about lawyers and court cases. It's fascinating to see how witnesses and testimonies are portrayed on the screen. The witnesses are sworn in, and they promise to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help them God. Which got me thinking, what is the purpose of a witness? Witnesses tell what they have seen, what they have heard. They tell of their experience. We share how our lives have been transformed by an encounter with Christ. We bear witness to the light and how the light changes us. We tell of the one who is to come, the Word made flesh, who will dwell among us. There's a retired Presbyterian minister, Vernon Hunter. He's from the Deep South, and he's well known for his charge to newly ordained clergy. He tells them, when you leave your mark on the church, it is nice when people say, what a great preacher she was. What a great pastor she was. What a caring and compassionate person she was. What an awesome minister she was. That's all nice and good, he says. But it would be so much better when people remarked about your impact on the church that they said, what a great God that worked through this servant of Jesus. What a witness she was to our Savior. That is the mark we are called to give, to leave. That we are the ones not who are the Savior, we are the ones who point to the Savior. We witness to the one who is to come. John's testimony of Jesus marks this third week of Advent. We look forward to Christmas, to the babe in a manger. And until then, we bear witness to the one who is to come. We look at our own lives. Do our lives bear witness to the light that shines in the darkness? In the midst of the darkness of our world, the disappointments, the dreary outlooks, the bad news that is all around us, that God is sending a light into this dark world? Do our lives reflect that coming light? These are trying times, but in the midst of trying times is a possibility for great testimony and witness, to share what you have seen, what you have heard, how you have experienced the coming of the Christ child, the one who is to come. Remember, we are not the Word, but we are the voice. We are not the light, but we are the ones who point to the light. And when we do that, when we point to the light or point to the one who is to come, we're fulfilling exactly who we are. We are witnesses to the coming of the King. Let us pray. Gracious God, we so often feel compelled and challenged and called to be like Jesus. But you call us to be more like John, to be the voice pointing to the one who was to come, the light into our dark world. Grant us the strength and the courage to do so. For this and all of our prayers, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us pray for the church and for the world. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church, that we all may be one. Grant that every member of the church may truly and humbly serve you, that your name may be glorified by all people. We pray for all bishops, priests, ministers, pastors, elders, and deacons, that they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world, that there may be justice and peace on the earth. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake, that our works may find favor in your sight. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble, that they may be delivered from their distress. Give to the departed eternal rest, Let light perpetual shine upon them. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others. Almighty God, to whom our needs are known before we ask, help us to ask only what accords with your will, and those good things which we dare not, or in our blindness, cannot ask. Grant us for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
It brings me great sadness to announce to you the deaths of two members of Indian Hill Church. The first, Betty Moore, a longtime member, passed away on Saturday, December 5th, and services for her will be on a private family graveside on Thursday, December the 17th. Betty was 91 years old. Also, the death of Charles Tommy Thomas. He also died on Saturday, December 5th, and services for Tom will be on Saturday, January the 9th, with a private family graveside at Spring Grove Cemetery. So please keep the Moore, Whitehouse, and Thomas families in your thoughts and prayers.
May the sun of righteousness shine upon you and scatter the darkness from before your path. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.